Morning. Oh, what a good God we serve. My scripture will be coming from Psalm 98, the first, second, and fourth verses, and the New King James translation. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained him the victory. The Lord has made known his salvation. His righteousness he has revealed in the sight of the nations. Shout joyfully to the Lord, all ye earth. Break forth in song, rejoice, and sing praises. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We serve a God that's worthy to be praised. We serve a good God. And I'm going to have us do some thinking this morning. Not you, but me too. And the thought is, the Lord blessed us. He blesses us every day. But there is sometimes that he blesses us so big that all we can say is thank you, Lord. We don't give him the praise that we should give him. We just say thank you, Lord, and keep it moving. Well, today I want all of us that can stand to think about that one thought, that one blessing that the Lord gave, and all you said was, thank you, Lord. It could have been a last payment on a mortgage. It could have been the last payment of a brand new car. It could have been that family member, that friend that you haven't seen in a long time. And they call you. It could be anything. And I just want us to shout and praise the Lord for as long as you can, for as many ways as you can, because our God is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah is the word, it's the highest praise we can give him. He is worthy. Oh, thank you, Lord. You are so worthy to be praised. You bless us every day. Thank you, Lord. You bless us with little things. Because we woke up this morning. Yeah. Hallelujah. We're here to worship and praise you. So we just want to give you some praise this morning that we forgot to give you, or we got too busy to give you, because you are worthy. Hallelujah. You are worthy to be praised. Thank you, Lord, for all that you have done, all that you are doing. And guess what, Lord? All that you're going to do. We thank you and we praise your name. We thank you, Lord, because you are worthy to the praise. You are a good God. We should sing your praises every day, not just in the morning, not just at noon, just not at night, but all the time. A song of praise should be in our minds, our mouths, our hearts, because you are worthy, Lord. You are worthy, Lord. You brought us thus far, right now. You've been so good to us, Lord. You brought us through a pandemic. Lord, you brought us through when the stores didn't have food. Hallelujah. But none of us went hungry, Lord. Lord, you gave us everything that we needed when we needed it. Hallelujah, Lord. That's your highest praise. I give you your highest praise, Lord, because you are worthy. Hallelujah, you're worthy to be praised. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all that you've done, all that you're going to do. Oh, hallelujah. Everybody, I just want you to remember, he deserves our praise. That's all he asks of us. And he gives us everything. He's given us life. Who gave you those clothes on your back this morning? Who put food on your table this morning? Who drove you? What did you drive into church this morning? Oh, he gives us all that we need, some of what we ask for. Oh, but he is worthy. Hallelujah, he is worthy. He is worthy to be praised. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah to your name. Everybody remember each and every day the goodness of the Lord. Because he is good to us every day. He is worthy to praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for all. Thank you, Lord. You are good. You're a good God to us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Worship him, everybody.
We worship Christ the Lord. We worship Christ the Lord. We lift our hands to you today.
Keep silenced before him. Hallelujah. The Lord is in his holy temple this morning. Let all the earth keep silence before him. We've come to lift up the name of Jesus this morning. My sister just started, finished talking about worshiping him. We are called to worship him. We are called to give him praise, to magnify him, to glorify him for who he is. And he is God all by himself. Hallelujah. We're glad that he sits high and he looks low. Father God, in the name of Jesus, God, we praise you this morning. We lift you up, God. We magnify you for who you are, God. God, we thank you, Father God, for your grace, and we thank you for your mercy this morning, God. God, we have not come to entertain this morning, God. We've come to lift up the name of Jesus this morning. God, we thank you for the word that shall come forth this morning, God. We glorify you this morning, God. We thank you for your covering this morning, God. God, and we thank you for having your way in this service this morning, God. Have your way, Father God. Have your way, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God. We glorify you, and we magnify you, and we exalt you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
word out that we are willing participants. That's the first step, he said. This is the second. Hey, I got it. Well, that may be it, but I got it. All right, we are joyfully welcoming you here this morning. We are so happy to see you. Do we have visitors today? All right. Oh, there you go, popped up. Okay. Can you shout out your name? Well, Mr. Williams, we are so happy to have you here this morning. We hope that you enjoy, we know you're going to enjoy the service because it's gotten off to a great beginning, and we know this is not going to be your last time. Amen. All right. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Williams. You know, the Lord sends what you need when you need it. And I was out there by myself this morning for a minute, and the Lord sent Miss Gwen Goodwin. And she said, can I help? Took a pad and a pencil and started checking you off, and it worked out. So I want to thank her. And I also want to give a mini shout out to Miss Pink and Green Boyer. Stand up. She's representing today. Thank you. All right. You know, pastors want to make sure that the congregation is paying attention and listening to them. You know, you can tell when pastor wants you to pay attention to what he's saying. And sometimes they do an experiment. Well, a priest did an experiment in his sermon, and he said, I want you to stand up if you want to go to heaven. And everyone stood up. And then he said, sit down. Now stand up if you want to go to hell. One person stood up, and the priest said, why on earth would you want to go to hell? The man said, oh no, Father, I don't want to go to hell, but I just couldn't bear seeing you stand up there all by yourself. Make wise choices, be safe, and God bless.
We Shall Overcome. We Shall Overcome was launched as the anthem of the American Civil Rights Movement in August of 1963. At the time, 300,000 civil rights supporters met at the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. There was a 22-year-old folk singer named Joan Baez led the crowd of 300,000 in singing We Shall Overcome. The singing of this song offered courage, comfort, and is hope to protesters confronting prejudice and hate in the battle for equal rights for African Americans. This song spread rapidly as the civil rights movement gained momentum. Protesters sung it as they marched for voting rights. They also sung it as they were beat up, attacked by police dogs, and hauled off to jail for breaking laws enforcing segregation. News and pictures of brutality shocked people across the US and around the world. Over the years, We Shall Overcome made the leap overseas, becoming a protest song among freedom movements and around the world.
Peace. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm here to lead the altar prayer. And I say lead because we all have to pray. And I thank God for the privilege of praying. And prayer is so important that the Lord gave us instructions on how to pray. He says in Matthew 6, therefore you should pray like this. Our Father in heaven, your name be honored as holy. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive others their offenses, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well. But if you don't forgive others, your Father will not forgive your offenses or offenses. Praise God for the instructions, and let us pray. Father God, we praise your holy name, for you are worthy to be praised. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Father, you're better to us than we are to ourselves. And we pray, Father God, that your will be done. There's a way that seems right to man, but it's not necessarily right to God. So, Lord, you know the desires of our hearts, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that we would have them aligned with what you would have us to desire. And, Lord, we just ask, Lord, you know what we stand in need of, and you know what we pray about. Nevertheless, we ask that your will be done. Lord, you know that we are fragile, Lord. So, Lord, have mercy on us, please. Lord, we pray for our young people, Lord God. That you would bless them, Lord. That you would protect them, Lord. That you would keep them, Lord. That you would give them strength to continue what we have started, Lord. And we just pray, Lord God, that all the shootings and violence that's going around, that you would handle all of that, Lord. You know the causes. It's not the lack of jails. It's other things, Lord. You know what they are. And we just pray that you would just handle everything, Father God, that peace will be still, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, for those that are mourning the passing of loved ones. We pray for Sister Donnie Richardson and the loss of her brother, the transitioning of Alexander Stedman. We pray for Sister Pearl Coxham, who's in the hospital right now. We pray for all of our sick and shut-ins, Lord God, that's on our list. And also the ones that are among us, Lord, today. Lord, we pray that you would touch them, please, Lord, with the hand of healing. We know that with God, all things are possible, Lord. So we come seeking your help, Lord. And Lord, we ask that we would, you would forgive us for our sins, Lord, for where we have missed the mark. Your word says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We come letting you know, Lord. Well, you already know. We come confessing, Lord, where we have messed up. Please forgive us and give us strength to do better. And Lord, help us to be forgiving also. Some of us, including myself, may be harboring grudges against people. Please forgive us and help us to let them go, Lord, because we cannot afford the luxury of unforgiveness. Because we need to be forgiven for what we have done. Therefore, please let us be forgiving to others and just let those grudges go, Lord. Lord, you know where they're at. And we ask, Lord God, that you would protect us from those things, Lord, that you know where we're weak, Lord. As your word says, protect us from temptations, Lord God. Your word says that there have no temptation taken, man. But such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer us to be tempted above what we are able, but will, with the temptation, also make a way for us to escape. Help us to always take that escape route, and help us to avoid the things and the areas and places and things that where we are weak, Lord. Help us to use the wisdom that you've given us. And Lord, we'll be careful to give you the thanks and the glory. And we thank you, Lord. And we just ask you to handle everything, Father God. And we pray, Father God, that we trust you, for faith is trusting God. And your word says, without faith or without trusting God, we cannot please you, Lord. So please help us, Lord, to trust in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, Corinthian. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. This morning I'll be reading from the book of Micah. I'll be reading from the King James Version. I'll be reading starting with Micah. Can you hear me now? Marvin, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Very good, my brother. Amen. We'll be reading, starting with the book of Micah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Amen. It says, King James Version, book of Micah, Old Testament, chapter 6, verses 1 through and including 8. I still hear papers turning, and I know that the Lord is with us, so we'll all get there together. Amen. We're not leaving anyone behind. Amen.
Okay.
I hear the deacons flipping pages also. So see there? We're all together. God bless you all. Amen. Chapter 6, Micah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Hear ye now what the Lord saith. Arise. Contend thou before the mountains, and let the hills hear thy voice. Hear ye, O mountains, the Lord's controversy, and ye strong foundations of the earth. For the Lord hath a controversy with his people, and he will plead with Israel. O my people, what have I said done unto thee? And wherewith have I wearied thee? Testify against me. For I brought thee up out of the land of Egypt, and redeemed thee out of the house of servants. And I have sent before thee Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what Balak, king of Moab, consulted, and what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him from Shittim unto Gilgad, that ye may know the righteousness of the Lord. Wherewith shall I come before the Lord, and how myself before the high God? Shall I come before him and with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, or with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He hath showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. Amen.
I would ask that we all stand, please, for the offertory prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you this morning, God, for these tithes and these offerings, Father God. God, we thank you, Father God, that you teach us how to give, God, and why we give, Father, and that it is better to give than to receive, Father God. God, teach us that we are just to be obedient to give, God, and you will work out the receiving, Father God. God, we magnify you this morning, God, and we glorify you, God. We ask in the name of Jesus that this offering is used for the upbuilding of your kingdom, God. God, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own has we give unto thee.
Good morning, Corinthian.
Good morning.
Okay, earlier, during Deacon Mack's altar prayer, he mentioned the passing of Sister Donnie Richardson's brother. And I just here to reiterate it. Friday morning, February 17th, my brother Alexander Edward Stedman transitioned. He will be funeralized at Smith Grove Missionary Baptist Church of Rens, Georgia on Thursday at 1 p.m. February 23rd. I believe it's a Fanzie and Son is the funeral home in charge. Also, Sister Willa Pearl Coaxum is in the Einstein Hospital. Thank you.
Good morning, Corinthian.
Good morning.
I am standing before you this morning on assignment to read a thank you card from someone very, 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 very close to me. And it reads as follows. Dear Corinthian, with sincere appreciation and warmest thanks to you all for your cards, gifts, thoughtfulness, and well wishes in recognition of my birthday. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. You made my day. With heartfelt gratitude, Sister Solomon.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Shall we bow our heads for a word of prayer? Father, we stretch our hands to thee. No other help we know. If you withdraw yourself from us, where shall we go? Father, it's in the name of Jesus that we, your people, boldly approach your throne of grace once again. Thanking you, God, for another opportunity to gather in your house, in your name, and with your people, with the sole purpose to worship and adore your great name and to celebrate you for giving us such a great salvation in Christ. Forgive us, O God, for things we have done that we should not have done. Forgive us, O God, for leaving things undone that ought to be done. Forgive us, O God, for doing the right thing for the wrong reason and the wrong motivation. Have mercy on us, your people. God, we pray even right now that anything that would separate us from a full experience and revelation of you and your word, that you would remove it even right now. We confess our sins to you. You said if we confess our sins, that you're faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Cleanse us now. Make us clean. And we'll be careful to give you praise, honor, and glory. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. For you are our strength and our most blessed Redeemer. Let us all say, amen. 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 Can we give God some praise for the youth this morning? I am just really excited about what I not only see, but sense that the Lord is doing in the lives of the young people of the Corinthian Baptist Church of Germantown. Amen. Amen. And I would encourage you to continue not only to keep the church in prayer, but let's keep our young people in prayer as well. Amen. Let's keep them encouraged. Let's support them. And we thank God for those who are providing leadership to the youth in this most critical season of the church as well. Amen. 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 And to the choir. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for leading us in worship this morning. As I listened to that great song, the instrumental Peace Be Still, one of the great powerful songs that is out of the antiquity of our people, my mind goes to a verse, I believe it's in Job 35, where Job talks about the songs in the night. You know, there's certain songs that you sing in church that, you know, that might be your jam, you know what I mean? But when trouble comes, when the circumstances of life are trying to steal your sleep, when things are happening in your life that are tempting you to worry, it's songs like Peace Be Still that my mama sings and that my grandmother sang and that my my pastor used to sing. Songs that I would laugh and joke about how y'all sang it when I was younger. But when I got a little older, when trouble started breaking out in my life, and I saw how mama had to get in the presence of the Lord, and she had to sing and listen and command her atmosphere. Somebody better hear me this morning. Tempted to worry on every side, but the Spirit of God would raise up in him. Look the devil in the face. Say, peace. Be still. I don't know what you're going through this morning, but why don't you just speak in the atmosphere and say, peace. Be still. You know you have authority to speak, don't you? But that's a different sermon. For a different day. Amen. The scripture has been read in your hearing from Micah chapter 6. A passage that I hope is familiar to all of you here today. If not, I would encourage you to go back and read it. Read the entire book of Micah. It's only 7 chapters, amen? Amen. But in the interest of time, I just want to read one verse in your hearing, which will constitute the focus of our preaching this morning. That all familiar verse, Micah chapter 6 and verse 8. I'm reading once again from the Christian Standard Bible. Hear these very similar words from Micah chapter 6, verse 8. And the Bible reads, mankind, he has told each of you what is good. And what it is the Lord requires of you. Amen. And then he unpacks what it is that he told us was good. He says that we are to, number one, act justly. Number two, to love faithfulness. Some of your versions may say, love mercy or kindness. And then finally, and to walk humbly with your God. Can I read that one more time? It's also good. Mankind, he has told each of you what is good. And what it is the Lord requires of you: to act justly, to love faithfulness, and to walk humbly with your God. With God's help this morning, I would like to teach and preach from the thought, a good spirituality. A good spirituality. Now, if you've been paying attention for the past several weeks, we've been talking about the topic of spirituality. We began by suggesting that the Christian understanding of spirituality begins when one experiences a spiritual rebirth. Jesus called it being born again. Being born again, according to John chapter 3, means to be born from above, to be born from heaven, or to be born of God who lives and reigns in heaven. But even though we've been born from above and we have this new connection, this new relationship with our God in heaven, our Christian faith is really a down-to-earth spirituality. In Colossians chapter 3, a couple weeks ago, we learned that when we follow the example of Jesus, we will conduct ourselves on earth in harmony with the will of God, the Father, who's in heaven. So that all that we do and all that we say will be done in the name of the Lord Jesus. Y'all were here for that, weren't you? And last week, I'm just trying to bring you up to where we are today for those of you who were here. Last week, we said a word about counterfeit spirituality. Y'all were here, weren't you? And I suggested to us that a counterfeit spirituality looks, sounds, and feels real, but it's fake. It's a cheap imitation of the real thing. It's a spirituality, deacons, that talks about Jesus, but doesn't preach what Jesus preached. It's a spirituality that praises Jesus, but does not follow Jesus. It's a spirituality that claims to worship Jesus, choir, but doesn't love what Jesus loves and hate what Jesus hates. It's a spirituality, listen, that does not do what Jesus did. And we learn from Amos chapter 5 that any spirituality that does not produce and prioritize the flourishing of justice in society is a counterfeit spirituality. This morning, Corinthian, I want to continue this conversation about spirituality under the theme, a good spirituality. Why don't you repeat it after me? Say, a good spirituality. Micah chapter 6 verse 8 says, mankind, he has told each of you what is good and what it is the Lord requires of you. It's a good spirituality, y'all. And so the question is, what is a good spirituality? Well, I wish I had something real deep and profound to say. But you know, it's always better to be plain so that you can understand it, right? Well, the answer to the question, what is a good spirituality, is a good spirituality does what is good. It does what the Lord requires. In other words, here's the point of the sermon. Spirituality becomes authentic. It becomes real when we make our lives available for God to meet the needs of others in God's name, listen, through us. I said spirituality becomes real. It becomes authentic when we make ourselves available for God to meet the needs of others through us. It's a spirituality that's demonstrated. This is what the New Testament calls good religion.
said good religion, y'all. I know I'm right about this because James chapter 1 verse 27, write it down. James chapter 1 verse 27 says, pure and undefiled religion. Some versions say good religion. Pure and undefiled religion before God the Father is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained from the world. That's James chapter 1 verse 27. Now, in Micah chapter 6, stay with me, y'all. In Micah chapter 6, we get an introduction to what I'm calling a good spirituality. Through the preaching of the prophet Micah, we begin to understand what true spirituality looks like. We begin to see what God means by a good spirituality. Now, the name Micah. Y'all still woke, won't you? Y'all don't sound woke. Y'all still woke? Micah. The name Micah means who is like Yahweh. Oh, you better hear me this morning. His name means who is like the Lord. Which suggests to us that if we're going to experience a good spirituality, a true spirituality, it begins with knowing Yahweh. It begins by knowing who the Lord is. I don't want to offend your sensibilities, but does anybody here know who the Lord is? I said, do you know who the Lord is out there, y'all? Can I talk about the Lord for a few seconds? Well, the Bible says that Yahweh is the self-existing God. Yahweh is the uncreated creator, which means that God is. I said God is. God is God. God is. God was, and God ever will be. God is the joy and the strength of my life. Yahweh told Moses, tell the people that I am. I'm talking about Yahweh this morning, y'all. That's why the psalmist said, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Our ancestors used to say it this way: he's God and God alone, and beside him there's no other. He's the one who spoke and the world came into being. And it's in him that we live, we move, and have our being. I'm talking about the Lord this morning, y'all. But here's the part that I love. Yahweh, the Lord, is the covenant-keeping God. Anybody know anything about covenant this morning? I said Yahweh is the covenant-keeping God, which means that when the Lord makes you a promise, can't no devil in hell block you from receiving it. When Yahweh speaks a word over your life, come hell or high water, it will come to pass. I said it's going to come to pass. And so the blessing of the Lord comes to God's people because God is good. I said God is good, y'all. God is good. Oh, I wish somebody believed that this morning. God is good. God is so good
that God still remains good even when we're bad. I said, God is good even when we're bad. Aren't you glad that the God we serve is good even when we're bad? Now, I know some of y'all can't appreciate that because y'all so goody two-shoes out there. But for those of you who knows, maybe that's why Micah's parents gave him that name. Who is like the Lord? Because they realized that there's none like him. He's an incredible God. And an incredible God deserves incredible praise. He deserves it, y'all. Because he's the God of all grace. But even though Yahweh is the God of all grace, who promises to bless us, he will confront us about our mess. That's what's going on in our text, y'all. The Lord has brought an indictment against his people because of their sin. Yahweh has brought a lawsuit against the people because they had violated the covenant. The Lord had blessed the nation with great prosperity, but everybody wasn't prospering. The rich got richer, and the poor got poorer. And God had had enough of this oppression, so he sent a prophet to preach to the nation. Why? Because God cannot tolerate corruption in society or in God's people. I said God can't tolerate it, y'all. God cannot tolerate dishonest gain. God can't tolerate materialism. God can't tolerate folks getting rich on the backs of the poor. God can't put up with the strong taking advantage of the weak. And so God reminds his people of their history. This is Black History Month, isn't it? God reminds his people of their history. God reviews his resume with the people. He says, you got it, you keep your Bible over verses 4-6. He says in verse 4, I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. Who is like Yahweh? And after the Lord saved them, you do know that the Lord didn't just save you and leave you alone, right? After the Lord saved them, they were led into the wilderness by a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And verse 5 says, oh, hear me this morning, y'all. Verse 5 says that when the enemy, how many of you got enemies out there? When the enemy tried to stop them from getting to the promised land, when the enemy tried to block them, when the enemy tried to curse them, they failed. I said, when the enemy tried to stop them, when the enemy tried to block them, the enemy tried to curse them, they failed. And they failed because, listen, you cannot curse what God has blessed. Hear me this morning. I said you cannot curse what God has blessed. Now, this is Black History Month. And many of us come from a lot of different backgrounds. And we have a lot of different traditions and beliefs. Can I say superstitions? Can I speak to some superstitions this morning? Because somebody needs to know that you cannot curse what God has blessed. See, you don't have to worry about somebody getting a piece of your hair. You don't have to worry about somebody putting salt in your door. You don't have to worry about folks so-called speaking a curse over your life. You don't have to worry and lose sleep because folks are turning the Bible over on you. If God has saved you, if God has redeemed you, if God has blessed you, can't no devil hex you. Can't nobody put a spell on you. I said, if God has blessed you. Is anybody here blessed by God? To make sure I'm in the right church every now and then. Is anybody here blessed by God? Well, if you're blessed by God, look at somebody, tell them, I'm blessed. Tell them, I'm blessed, and it ain't nothing you can do about it. I'm telling you, you cannot curse what God has blessed you. I wish I could stay there, y'all. And then the Bible says that God eventually led God's people across the Jordan River into the promised land. God led them to claim their inheritance. Who is like Yahweh, y'all? Now, there are three components to a good spirituality. And they're all right here in the text. We just read it. Mankind, he has told each of you what is good. And what it is the Lord requires of you. To act justly. To love faithfulness. And to walk humbly with your God. Now, if you're taking notes. The first component is doing justice. Somebody say doing justice. Doing justice. Not talking about justice, not debating about justice, not just preaching about justice, but I said doing justice, y'all. Now, I took you through all of this for a purpose, y'all. Remember the context. God is speaking to a people whose ancestors were slaves. About acting justly. I said, remember the context. God is speaking to a people whose ancestors were enslaved about acting justly. Why? Because, listen, their historical experiences should have made them sensitive to the suffering not only of their people, but the suffering of all people. Oh, I ain't get too many claps on that one there. This is Black History Month, isn't it? Well, I believe that this is a word for African Americans. In other words, let me say it this way. Our people were not always free. Our people could not always live where they live. They could not always drive what you drive. They could not go to school where you went to school. They could not work where you now work. They did not have access to power and privilege like some of you now have. Why? Because our ancestors were in bondage. They used to be the victims of gross injustice. They used to be excluded from society. They used to live on the margins of the nation. They used to be the other. They lived in segregation. They used to have to submit to Jim Crow laws. But God. I said, but God. You see, God redeemed them. God delivered them. God saved them from slavery. Who is like Yahweh? And now, somebody say now. And now, we, you and I, not only should hate injustice, but we need to stand in solidarity with the victims of oppression. Those who are victimized by racism, poverty, unjust wars, and the inequitable distribution of goods, resources, and services. Do justice. Doing justice look like today, y'all? When we do justice, we ought to make sure that there's integrity in the administration of justice in the legal system. We need to advocate for the marginalized and protect their rights in accordance with God's laws. You see, to do justice is to show love for our neighbor, whether they're an immigrant, a prisoner, homeless, mental ill, physically challenged, homosexual, old, young, overweight, male, female, black, white, or anything else in between. I told you last week, Cornel West says that justice is love in action. A good spirituality does justice. And justice loves across any and every boundary set by society. Secondly, a good spirituality loves mercy. Somebody say mercy. To put it another way, y'all. A good spirituality has a heart. Oh God, don't let's ever let us lose our heart in church. A good spirituality has a heart that's responsive to the needs of others. It's a heart that understands that it's been blessed to be a blessing. And that heart responds this way because it's been filled with a loyal love, a faithful love. It's a spirituality that's compelled to help others. You know what compelled means, right? That's how we used to say it in the old church. I had a bad case of the I can't help myself. It's a commitment to meet others' legitimate needs. I said legitimate needs. Now, this command to love mercy is akin to the African philosophy known as Ubuntu. Somebody say Ubuntu. Ubuntu. Say Ubuntu. Ubuntu. Ubuntu is rooted in the worldview, listen, that I am because we are. Somebody say, I am because we are. Which means that part of your personal identity is rooted in the community from where you're from. So Ubuntu means that we put the good of the community before our personal needs. It means showing kindness to those we live with. It describes the loyal and positive ways we ought to be connected. You see, this is Black History Month, ain't it? We are an African descended people, aren't we? You see, Ubuntu, when it's in effect, we cannot ignore the misery of the weak all around us. When Ubuntu is in effect, we cannot shut our hearts to God's promptings to do something about the suffering of the poor. When we love mercy, when Ubuntu is in effect, it will cause us to pay attention to the victims of injustice. It'll cause us to show compassion to those who are in desperate need, and it will help us love God with a pure heart. So, doing justice is a way of loving mercy. And loving mercy is a manifestation of the final component of a good spirituality, which is to walk humbly. Hear it again, y'all. It's a progression. Doing justice is a way of loving mercy. And loving mercy is a manifestation of what it means to walk humbly before your God. Micah says, what the nation needs to do is repent. Because God had already told them what he desired. Can I apply it to us? Amen. Micah says that those of us sitting here this morning in the Corinthian Baptist Church of Germantown need to repent. Because God has already told us what he desires. What he requires of them and what he requires of us is a good spirituality. What God requires of us is good. Somebody say good. What God forbids is evil. Somebody say evil. Now, God and God alone is good, and God wants us to do good. God wants us to do justice, love mercy, and to walk humbly before our God. There's no point, y'all, in coming to church every week. Or every other week. Or once a month. Or Christmas, Mother's Day, and Easter. There's no point in coming if we're going to ignore God's demands for righteous living. Ain't no need to preach. No need to sing on the choir. No need to be a deacon or an usher if we're not willing to do what God says. I'm talking about walking humbly before God this morning, y'all. And so since that's the case, we all, from the pulpit to the door, from the ceiling to the floor, we all need to humble ourselves. We need to do what God tells us to do. To walk humbly means that we have fellowship with God. It means to walk with God as a constant companion. Anybody know what it means to walk with God as your companion? Tell somebody, say, I'm a friend of God. Sometimes you just got to sit in that. Tell somebody else, I'm a friend of God. I don't know what you think about me, but I'm a friend of God. To walk humbly before God means that you realize that God is God and you're not. It means being gladly submissive to God's will. And the reason we have this attitude of humility is because even though things may look bad in our world, we never lose faith in the future. Because we are people of hope. And hope, I told you before, is a confident expectation. Hope maketh not ashamed. I'm closing now, y'all, but if you have your Bible, I want you to turn to look at two verses. Micah chapter 7, verses 17 and 18. Micah chapter 7, verses 17 and 18. You want to know why you should have some hope? Even though you messed up. You want to know why God is still good even when we're bad? Who is like Yahweh, y'all? Micah chapter 7, verses 17 and 18 says, listen, y'all. Who is a God like you? Forgiving iniquity and passing over rebellion for the remnant of his inheritance. Listen, y'all. He does not hold on to his anger forever. Hallelujah. He does not hold on to his anger. He's not like some of us. He does not hold on to his anger forever. Listen, because he delights in faithful love. He will again have compassion on us. He will vanish our iniquities. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. Cast your sins into the depths of the sea. And the old preacher when I was growing up used to say, and when he cast them into the depths of the sea, he put a sign up there saying, no fishing. Aren't you glad? Oh, I wish I had some saved folk here this morning. not matter where you've been. It does not matter what you did. It does not matter what they say about you, what they think about you, when you have been forgiven. He will cast your sins. I love the way the psalmist said it in, I think it's Psalm 103, that he will separate you from your sins as far as the east is from the west. And if you remember your geography, if you go east, you will never get west, which means that you will never catch up to your sins, and your sins will never catch up to you. He will free you. And so somebody come up to you, talk about your past, and say, you know what, so what? It's under the blood. He has buried it. Now, if God loves you that way, if God is willing to forgive you with all that he knows about you and I, who are you to try to hold somebody else bondage? Who are you to try to... If God has forgiven me, stay up out of my business. I said, if God has forgiven me. Hallelujah. He'll bury it and put up a sign. No fishing. Which means that when it's buried, he ain't gonna bring it up. Start. This is what the Bible calls restoration. He will forgive you. He will reconcile you. He will restore you. He will give you a new lease on life. He will save you. All he wants to hear is, Lord, have mercy. Stand on your feet this morning. Stand on your feet.
We have been redeemed. We have been redeemed. Praise God. Thank you, God, for forgiveness.
Oh. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank
you, Lord.
Hallelujah. God is calling us to a true biblical, Christian, spirit-filled, word-form spirituality. Where we've been born again. Not just a church member. I'm a member of the church. Ain't nothing wrong being a member of the church. But you need to be a member of God's church. And when you're forgiven of your sins and a member of God's church, even though you are seated with Christ in heavenly places, you still have a down-to-earth spirituality. Not a counterfeit spirituality. Not a one that claims that it loves God and can't stand nobody in the church. Can you love God who you've never seen and use your mouth to talk against somebody who's made in the image and likeness of God? God is trying to break something in this place. Not just at Corinth, in the body of Christ. God is trying to bring healing to the church. Spiritual healing, physical healing, emotional healing. The God we serve, his name is Jehovah Rapha. He is the God who heals. We've been reading about it, but God wants to show up. I told you last week, I believe it was, that God is able to heal a broken spirit as easy as he can heal a sick body. Y'all don't believe that. Y'all don't believe that. The God we serve is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think. God is able. But do you have enough will to believe? The doors of the church are open. Somebody needs to be saved today. Somebody needs to be delivered today. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you've been. I don't care what you've done. The God we serve, because of Christ, the Bible says, preachers help me out here, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Because Christ died, God no longer holds your sins against you. Which means that God's not mad at you. God ain't mad at you.
You've been redeemed.
But see, the problem is, y'all, some of us are so prideful. You hear that God is willing to forgive you, but you won't forgive yourself. You have put more stock in what they said about you than what God is saying about you. God is trying to give you a new life. God wants to give you a fresh start. God wants to drink from the wells of salvation and be saved, delivered, and set free. The doors of the church are open to you today. You may be here physically. You may be tuning in virtually. Today is the day of salvation. The day that you hear his voice. Do not harden your heart. Is there one this morning? Even if you don't fully understand, come, let us talk to you. We'll pray with you. We'll open up the scriptures for you. I'll tell you my story. I'll tell you that this ain't no fairy tale, y'all. You see, there's some things that you can argue about. We can debate about a whole lot of stuff. I'll do it. I've been doing it for years. Y'all know I worked in the shelter system. Believe me, I don't hurt at all. But I discovered that nobody can argue with a changed life. Listen, we can go through with all the holy books of the world all you want to. But when you've been born again, when you've been born from heaven, there is no argument that can contradict a changed life. Some parent needs to hear that this morning. Stop arguing with your kids on this level. Walk in obedience. Let them see a change in your life. Let them see you on your knees. Let them see you reading your scripture. Let them see you loving your neighbor. Let them see you change the way you used to respond to them. Let them see that.
You can't argue with the changed life. Last call. You may already be a Christian, but you're not a part of a church right now. You need to be a part of God's church. You need to be a part of a community of faith to learn about this good spirituality, to learn to avoid the counterfeit and live a down-to-earth life like Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit. Is there one? While the choir sings one verse. If you know the song, let's sing it with him. Never to leave me. He's never ever. I've got to fast and pray. Keep my life clean. I want to go with him. I've come too far. God is. God is. Prepare to ask the Lord's blessings and benediction. While the Spirit of God is still moving, I pray that God's word will continue to speak to your hearts long after the message is done. You do know that the Spirit of God is the after preacher. Anybody know anything about the Spirit of God following you home? When you're born again, you can't just walk away from certain messages. Some messages bring you comfort. Some messages bring you encouragement and consolation. But there are other messages that bring you to your knees. Let him have his way in your life. Bow your heads. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Let us all sing together. Go in peace. God bless you.